Alright guys, it's 9:32, Friday night. This is what I do on a Friday night. I'm tired, my feet are aching from all this walking. I got these compression socks to kind of, I've had them on, I don't know. I should have my feet raised, but I'm not lying down. I don't lie down that much. I just took a shower, that's why I'm like trying to get the water out of my ears. Yes, I know, you're not supposed to stick Q-tips in your ears. This is a paper towel. I've been worried about that, but when I saw the doctor last, this wasn't just recently, but I didn't have any stocked up wax in my ears, so I guess that's the way I'm doing it. What I wanted to do was, I like to watch a lot of videos on YouTube. I've been watching a lot of Richard Grannon, Sam Vaknin, and a few others. I wanted to kind of go through them while I watch them. There's a few that, because I'm growing in my interest regarding my issues, and to kind of get the multitasking down. Now I know multitasking sucks, okay? Because you don't concentrate on anything, you don't focus. I have trouble focusing. But sometimes for things that are mundane, like filling up a soap washer with soap, and I can't justify in my head that I would actually spend time doing that, I do it while filming and talking to you. So it's like I'm doing things at the same time. There's one thing I'm kind of concentrating on, but everything else is kind of just like going. It works for me. It makes me feel like I'm doing something. Otherwise, if I focus on one thing, it can't be for that long. So this is how I am usually. And I'm uploading at the same time. Hopefully it won't pause again and I'll have to stop it, but because this is the second time. The internet's been a little weird. It could be if I'm playing this video, it will pause. You'll see my frustration. But anyways, I see something here. I'm not gonna show the video of it. I'm just gonna show, I'm gonna play it and stop it and talk about it if there's something that interests me. It's 48 minutes. Yeah. But I figured that would give out other content for the channel, which is picking up viewers. So, I'm getting motivated to put more and more videos, like, it's really, and my TV went off. Like, I have my iPad attached to a TV, and the TV is very fickle. So, I turn this off again, and I turn it back on. If not, I'll just listen to the iPad. But anyways. Okay, this is fun, so we'll see what happens with that. Maybe I'll do reaction videos to other people's videos, you know, like that's kind of, is that still a thing? There's a few reaction channels, but might as well talk about them, you know. So why can't I succeed? Internal blocks, I'll leave the link in the description if I can still find it. Right now you'll be watching my LA videos, and I'll probably just intersperse this in after I transfer this to the computer. So a lot of things going at the same time. Okay, internal blocks to success installed. That sounds like me a lot. So if this interests you, pay attention as I click off some things on TubeBuddy. Now it's going to take a while for the video to start because I'm using the internet to upload. And there's no cuts in this video. Okay.
Today we're going to talk about complex PTSD and being raised inside of an abusive family unit.
Complex PTSD. This is what I'm interested in. 27 years of growing up in a piece of shit household, right? I stayed till 27 because I was like, fuck you to my parents, you did this to me, I'm gonna fucking make your life miserable and I'm just gonna stay here and do nothing. Until I realized that this wasn't helping me. So then I got up and I left. Was that TMI? I don't know. Here we go, let's play.
And being the black sheep, the scapegoat inside of that family unit, what the effects of that emotional and psychological abuse can be, how that complex PTSD manifests, and what you can do about it. This is a question that comes from Raph.
Can you hear?
And it starts...
Put this way.
Completely lagging the time here because I just pressed the wrong button. I'm using Windows 8 and I think that they've deliberately designed Windows 8 to be the least human friendly it can possibly be. It's completely confusing and everything is...
I'm using Windows 7.
Totally counterintuitive. Okay. As a direct result of the abuse, I'm just cherry picking this from the email here. As a direct result of the abuse and emotional neglect that I experienced, one major hallmark of my CPTSD is the lack of being internally focused and self-serving.
That sounds like me. By the way, I'm going to be fixing my hair at the same time. And again, multitasking, it's my meditation, so just pay attention to the video. Hopefully Richard won't do a copyright strike on it. This is transformative anyways because I'm talking about it.
A recurring theme in my conversations with Ravi is we talk a lot about how his ability to be self-nurturing, follow through and find success in life and be forward moving and assertive and...
This is hard for me sometimes to be assertive and forward moving. I start something and then sometimes things piss me off and then I have to kind of stop it. And it's been a pattern. Some things have gone through, but some things have been hard. I could really relate to that.
You know, masculine in a healthy way has been damaged by his experiences growing up. Sometimes I refer to this by the Malay word semangat, S-E-M-A-N-G-A-T, which is a word that means spirit, energy, intention, your ability to move forward. If your semangat is damaged, your ability to nurture yourself and protect yourself and look after yourself and make good decisions, moving in alignment with your highest values is very, very difficult. Emotional abuse in any environment that goes on for a long enough period of time, if it's intense enough or long-lasting enough, the corrosion that it does to the sense of self, to the semangat, is very damaging.
Yeah, like I guess being told that I wasn't going to be a people person, that I should just stick to basic jobs. Initially, when my father wanted me to be, you know, a doctor, all these, you know how Jewish parents are, they want you to be a doctor because they've been nothing in their lives. But my mother wasn't, she was the one who said, I don't know, it's really hard for me to describe, but they were very, ununderstanding, unnurturing. Hard to put in words, but I can relate.
And it's quite hard to heal. It's complicated to heal. That's why it's called complex PTSD. That's not really why it's called complex PTSD. It's differentiated from straightforward PTSD. From a very early age, my mum would scold me for being selfish and inject guilt into me for wanting things for myself only. A lot of these stories that I hear around CPTSD and childhood environments where people, you know, adverse childhood environments, they tend to involve parents who clearly are personality disordered, frequently even have a typically without wanting to get into a discussion of definitions and what it means and doesn't mean, but the typical description for borderline personality disorder, you'll have a borderline personality disorder mother and a classically over narcissistic or possibly psychopathic father. One or both parents might be a rage addict, extreme.
This is so funny because up until my father died just a few months ago, he kept saying that my mother was crazy, she was sick in the head, and, you know. Why the fuck did you marry her? Well, he didn't marry her, it was common law, as I found out later. And it's like, realizing that you're the fucked up one, you fucking piece of shit. Let's go back to the,
dysregulation is the result of the family unit. A lot of hypocritical changing, altering of the narrative, and a lot of rules that just don't make sense or that change capriciously from day to day.
Yep, yep.
Obviously, a borderline mother or a borderline father would do the same thing. I hear a lot about the classically, what we call borderline. But I'm getting into that, you know. Here's the thing, I've been meaning to do a video on feminism for a long time. I personally really, really like feminism, but my experience with feminism was positive. When I was at university, I thought psychology was a load of shit.
I don't have any opinion on feminism. I don't. I'm not there yet. Sorry.
I did okay. I got my degree. But my third year, out of spite, perversion, just a desire.
I think my father was the female of the household. He was very effeminate. He was in his gestures. He reminds me of Hitler, my father, because Hitler was a gay guy, a little effeminate guy who had a chip on his shoulder and was short and not very imposing. So he had to go into rage against people, you know, kind of like Hitler. Classic, you know what I mean? Okay, back to this.
I had to be, you know, a bit wacky. I did a module in feminism as a, just for like, whatever, you know, it's like a churlish adolescent move. I was like, yeah, I'll do a module on feminism. And then I actually really liked it because not the feminism that you're familiar with on the cyberwebs and the blogosphere and the YouTubes, but genuine, authentic, academic feminism that isn't just, you know, misandry.
Let me see if I can fast forward this, because this isn't touching me at all right now.
The way that men typically describe narcissistic men, the way that, what did I just say? Hello. Sorry, I'm not taking any caffeine at the moment, sometimes I get a bit hazy. The way that women typically describe narcissistic men is fueled with a lot of sexist ideology. It's not gender neutral, and it's not critically thought through. So I'm not going to get into it today, but this is typical of a borderline mother, as it is reported to me, borderline being a questionable subtype only of narcissism that actually sometimes is misdiagnosed from CPTSD, etc., etc. But the typical borderline: massive fear of abandonment, huge amounts of dysregulation, the malignant borderline, who is basically a subtype of narcissist, that nasty predatory borderline, will use guilt and shame on her children to control them. Her fear, the borderline, this is...
It just occurred to me, I don't know about my mother being borderline, but I just realized that she was probably a covert narcissist because she was so passive-aggressive. I just learned this about a year ago, what passive aggressivity is, because the guy from Toronto that I dated was like that when he was so lazy and he would say, or do something wrong, so then I would have to do it. My mother was so much like that. I'm like, can you help me do this? Oh, I can't do it, you do it. Like, her whole life, that's all I knew growing up. And I just thought she was a fat fucking lazy cunt, you know what I mean? And I would get extremely angry and extremely violent too. I was very violent because that's all I knew growing up. FYI. So it just occurred to me that, yeah, my father was the overt narcissist and my mother was a covert. She wasn't a codependent. My father was more dependent on my mother because when she died, like he kept saying for many years, you see me getting anxious. For many years he kept saying, you know, I'm going to break this accent. I'm going to break up the home. I'm going to send your mother in the home. I'm going to put you in a group home and I'm going to sell the house. Well, fuck, I do it. For decades he'd been doing that. And when she died, oh my God, she loved me. I have no one to take care of me. You're a fucking old man. Take care of your fucking self, you piece of shit. Back to the video.
The video that I meant to do, I still never got around to doing it. There's a link out there. It's called something like, it's something like the daughters of borderline mothers, or daughters being raised by borderline mothers. And it describes, there's an article, I'll find it for you, the process by which it's not just for daughters, it works for sons as well. If I am a borderline mother, or indeed a borderline father, I'm going to keep pre-qualifying and post-qualifying. You know, I realise I need to do a bit more pre-qualifying and post-qualifying based on recent events. I need to make myself really clear. So imagine for a moment, put down your weaponry for a moment, put down your pitchforks for a moment, and imagine I'm a borderline mother. So I have a little baby. Now, my thing is massive fear of abandonment. I have a damaged sense of self. I had a sketchy relationship with my own parents, and my emotions were up and down, but I also feel entitled, and I'm also quite manipulative, and I am addicted to supply, narcissistic supply as we would normally know it. This is where Richie runs off the range.
I'm going to rewind it because I have to catch it again. I don't know if you caught it. I didn't.
On social constructionism, the way in which we construct ideas. So I don't want to get into a thing today about the fact that borderline, as we understand it, and narcissism, as we understand it, is massively sexist. The way that men describe borderline women comes with a huge amount of sexist assumptions. The way that men typically describe narcissistic men, the way that, what did I just say? Hello. Sorry, I'm not taking any caffeine at the moment. Sometimes I get a bit hazy. The way that women typically describe narcissistic men is fueled with a lot of sexist ideology. It's not gender neutral, and it's not critically thought through. So I'm not going to get into it today, but this is typical of a borderline mother, as it is reported to me, borderline being a questionable subtype only of narcissism that actually sometimes is misdiagnosed from CPTSD, etc., etc. But the typical borderline: massive fear of abandonment, huge amounts of dysregulation, the malignant borderline, who is basically a subtype of narcissist, that nasty predatory borderline, will use guilt and shame on her children to control them. Her fear, the borderline, this is another video that I meant to do ages ago, I never got around to doing it. There's a link out there, it's called something like, it's something like the daughters of borderline mothers, or daughters being raised by borderline mothers. And it describes, there's an article, I'll find it for you, the process by which...
I don't know if I can relate to this part, because I just had a lot of anger towards my mother. And one time I thought I had an Oedipus complex when I was younger. That was weird. But I don't know about that. But I had a lot of anger that... First of all, she was with a fucking K-word. She should have fucking got up and left. They both slept in separate rooms. They never had sex after me. And like, why the fuck are you there? You know? I was angry for that. And I'm liking doing these videos because it gets all this emotion out of me. But... yeah, I was angry that she wasn't doing anything, and wow, now I'm thinking about it. This guy in LA that I'm dating, Mr. Toronto, these are people who are doing nothing that I feel. My mother was big and obese. The guy in LA is obese. The guy in Toronto is obese, and so cute though, but obviously I'm dating people who are like my mother. Sometimes I date people that are like my father. When I lived in LA for a year, I think the guy was more like my father. But if you're watching this, you might already know that you tend to do patterns and you either date people who are like your mother or your father. Either way, and you can't stop who you're attracted to. It's already set. Correct me if I'm wrong. This is what I know right now, but what do I know? I don't know much. I'm learning.
It's not just for daughters, it works for sons as well. If I am a borderline mother, or indeed a borderline father, I'm going to keep pre-qualifying and post-qualifying. I've realised I need to do a bit more pre-qualifying and post-qualifying based on recent events. I need to make myself really clear. So imagine for a moment, put down your weaponry for a moment, put down your pitchforks for a moment, and imagine I'm born my mother. So I have a little baby. Now, my thing is massive fear of abandonment. I have a damaged sense of self. I had a sketchy relationship with my own parents, and my emotions were up and down, but I also feel entitled, and I'm also quite manipulative, and I am addicted to supply, narcissistic supply as we normally know it, and this is where Richie runs off the range a little bit and does his own thing. I personally think a typical borderline, as is frequently described, and in my personal opinion, I've seen just as many borderline, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, men, as I have women. The malignant borderline, that narcissistic borderline, that very emotional, vulnerable, they call it a vulnerable narcissist, they also call it the covert narcissist, he says, not wishing to digress. So, my thing is, I have a baby, and this baby is physically dependent on me. I mean, this baby doesn't judge me, it needs me, it can't leave. It physically depends on me for its existence, and it's almost like a perfect relationship for someone who's massively afraid of being abandoned. And I am godlike with this baby. It literally feeds from my body. If you're breastfeeding, literally it needs me to live. To the extent,
I don't know if that was the case with me. My mother had a stroke when she had me. My mother was kind of like a child. And like a retarded child. So I don't know. I'm learning.
That it is an appendage for the first 6-12 months of life before the central nervous system has developed, before the immune system has developed properly. It is an appendage because if you take the baby away from me, its survival rates will go down. As we
go a little further,
when you're talking about narcissistic family units, control the child has is over its own bodily functions. It can put themselves in any narrative to twist the narrative so that they themselves are the victim, no matter how awfully they have behaved. So that narcissistic supply of the borderline or of the covert narcissist way, because now you're inflicting narcissistic injury accidentally. Yes. So.
Sorry.
What is he saying? He's saying the baby is perfect. Now, as the baby starts to individuate, as it should, and become its own person, it reaches that age of saying no. To go a little bit Freudian for a second, it realizes that it has the ability, the first control the child has is over its own bodily functions. It can choose to either go to the toilet or not. Wow, what power. And the euphoria that brings. It can say no. It can become angry, the child.
Well, I didn't learn how to cook from my parents. I didn't learn how to do laundry. Like, they did all that stuff. So maybe that was me becoming, needing them in a kind of covert way. I remember also that laundry, this. I forget. Let's play.
There'll be people in the comments going, he called a human child it. He's a psychopath. The child, so I don't have to keep saying he or she. Okay, let's say she. She can become angry. She can become clingy to the mother. My jealous. Don't you come towards my mummy, that's my mummy. Stay away from my mummy. All of these things, the child starts to individuate. My point is, I'm rambling, sorry. The mother will punish the child for the individuation, for the attempt to move away, because now you're inflicting narcissistic injury, accidentally. Narcissistic in the broad term, also including malignant borderlines within it. A borderline can have injury inflicted upon him or her very quickly and very easily. Hypersensitivity and lack of boundaries, right? Remember, lots of bees. Hypersensitive, no boundaries. Very dodgy sense of self, very dependent on affirmation from the environment. Oh, I drifted off the range before, but I didn't finish. Does narcissistic supply, I think with your typical borderline, that narcissistic supply is a little bit different. They're addicted to sympathy. So their whole game is to foster sympathy and to constantly put themselves.
I think my mother was addicted to me being angry. Because my father used to beat up on my mother. And then I started getting angry towards my father and my mother. And maybe she was addicted to that. Yeah.
In any narrative, to twist the narrative so that they themselves are the victim, no matter how awful, awfully they have behaved. So that narcissistic supply of the borderline, or of the covert narcissist, who is also known as the vulnerable narcissist, there will be you will have this, yes, I want to be the king, the big, the strong, the greatest, the bestest, the most important, most wonderful, prettiest, smartest, whatever in the room. But then you'll see that variation of that, and you'll see cerebral kinesthetic, somatic narcissism in one person, and you'll see overt and covert tendencies in one person. And it's even been suggested that really overt and covert is meaningless, but they're just descriptions of strategies for gathering narcissistic supply, not of different personality disorders. Again, I'm not going there today. So they're addicted to sympathy. They become addicted to sympathy and being seen as the victim. Think about that for a moment. Think about people you know.
I guess I saw my mother as a victim. Like, why the hell are you staying there? Just checking that this is still filming. Why are you, that was always the case. Even till the last few years, you know, and it would always get me angry. Why are you such a weak piece of shit? Yeah.
Whom that might apply, where every story that they have, the end game seems to be to get you to sympathize with them. Okay. So borderline mummy, little baby, boy or girl, doesn't matter, little baby starts to move away from me. Oh, that, I don't like that. That, no, I don't, that doesn't feel good. Don't say no to me. Don't you fucking say no to me. Now, the no mummy, I'm not going to do that. Well, no, and the, you know, the child will like smack that. I saw a kid do this recently, it was hilarious. Like, the mum didn't give the sweet fast enough. Child's like, no, bad mummy, and smacked her in the knee. That's like, it's amazing. Expression of power. So, you know, this will inflict a kind of narcissistic injury. So I'm trying to explain. It's complicated, and it requires like a subtle understanding of all these different layers and levels in order for the work to be effective. Otherwise, just end up chasing your own tail. If you paint with broad brushstrokes, you're a meanie and easy goody. You know, it's not, you're not going to get anywhere like that, because that's not what it is. That's not reality. You're creating a map of reality that is too simplistic. Like if you drew England and went, well, it basically looks like this. Yeah, that'll do. There you go. Now, right, now take a ship around the coast. What's going to happen? You're going to hit the rocks because the map is not enough. Or it just won't work. It just will not work. You just keep spinning your wheels. So the mother starts to punish the child every time the child asserts. Now, that could be the child asserting herself